I have to do, I told him I would do the application.
Good evening, I'm opening up the council meeting of December 12, 2016. Councilmember Chapman?
Here.
Councilmember Clayton?
Here.
Councilmember Kendall?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Here.
Mayor Moore?
Here.
Please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection, please. Flag salute. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let me steal this for a second.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coast and the Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, and posted on the bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. Thank you.
You're welcome.
City manager's report on issues raised at the prior council meetings.
Is this on? None at this time.
Special event applications, Leisha.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. The first application before you is the Sons of Ireland Polar Bear Plunge, which would be held on New Year's Day on Fifth Avenue Beach from 10 to 3 p.m. Next is the St. Patrick's Day Parade in Kennedy Park, which is done in conjunction with the city's St. Patty's Day Parade on March 12th from 1 to 6. On June 13th, the fire department is seeking to do the 5-alarm 5K fundraiser in conjunction with St. Barnabas Hospital from 6 to 7:30 p.m., and that's a Tuesday evening. The remaining applications are all weddings for 2017. Any questions?
No. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next on the agendas are items to be presented. We have one item by Sackman Enterprises.
Andrew Karras from Fox Rothschild on behalf of Sackman Enterprises. I'm going to move this mic up a little bit. We're here tonight with regard to an informal presentation of what we're looking to do on 605 Madison Ave, a proposal to put a building up there that we're looking to go up a significant height. We're going up to, we're looking to go up 180 feet. Right now, by ordinance that was enacted, I believe in 2006, gave my client permission to go up to 96 feet from what had been 70 feet. We can assume with regard to this presentation, I'll be calling Jim Garrison, an architect, to provide some testimony on this. Is there three critical elements that
when you say, it, just for my edification,
sure.
Instead of saying feet, can you say stories or floors?
I'll have the architect go into the amount of stories. But for purpose of the legal purposes and what we're going to be looking for, zone amendment, it's going to happen in terms of feet. So
okay.
I look at the return in terms of feet.
No problem.
Three critical elements that are going to be included within this proposed building. Number one, it's going to have a parking deck that's going to have 586 parking spaces, which is a significant increase in benefit, obviously, to the downtown, seeing the situation that exists in terms of the lack of parking. So it'll add a significant amount of parking to this building and also other parking in the area. Second thing is we're going to provide within this building a supermarket that is critically needed within the community, all of Asbury Park, including the downtown. There's 15,000 square feet that will be set aside in order to provide for a supermarket, which would be, again, a significant benefit to the entirety of Asbury Park. Third, as will be presented by the architect, the building is not just going to be environmentally friendly, it's going to be actually environmentally state-of-the-art. There'll be a vertical garden, vertical farm that's going to be on the outside of this building, which will be very unique to any type of building, especially in the downtown area. With that being said, I'll have Jim Garrison go through what is being proposed. He has a number of boards that we're going through that will show the design and location within Asbury Park on the 605 Madison site.
Jim?
Hi, everyone. Good evening. Jim Garrison, Steve O'Hara. Steve's been working hard drawing these drawings for Saturday, and asked us to look at a building on this site. I guess you know the site, between Bangs and Madison. It's an interesting site because it's part of this beautiful downtown.
I have two.
It's full of buildings from the 19th century, basically, that give it a great character. So one of the things that characteristic of that time is, of course, this, you know, this height, the height of the street wall. I mean, when people used to build in that era, they all agreed to build at a certain height. They all said, well, we'll make a city out of six-story buildings, four-story buildings. We'll line things up, and it'll give a kind of coherence and kind of good sense to things. So we had to look at that in the face of having to build a larger building for the purposes of balancing out the cost of all of the things that go into this. So what we did is, we said, well, all right, we could position a building, I don't know if you can see this, that goes, that is tall and goes from street face to street face. Or we could rotate it 90 degrees and put it in the center of the site and set it back from the street faces. The difference is that when it goes from street face, it looks like this. Basically, the mass of the building, whatever height it is, shows here. This is the old Madison building on the corner, and this, you can see the, what we're trying to do is get the height, and of course, we have to go above it for the apartment house. And then when we turn it 90 degrees, we don't see it from the street. And that's the idea, to keep the scale under control. So let's go to the next one. All right, so the plan of the building, these are kind of abstract. There's basement parking for quick in-and-out parking for the grocery store. Grocery store faces Madison. This is the queuing arrangement for what is a robotic parking garage. Basically, you pull up, you put a card into a slot. You get out of your car, you walk to the sidewalk, a machine takes your car up and puts it in the slot. And when you want to get it back, you put the card in, and it comes down and delivers it to you. You come in one side, and the machine exits the other side. Maximum waiting time is just over 2 minutes in most crowded circumstances. And that parking garage makes the first six stories above the grocery store. The grocery store is a double height space with a mezzanine along Madison. It's a big, generous, old-style hall of Madison. Then when we go upstairs, at the height of roughly six stories, now we say that the parking is six stories above the retail base, and that's right, but the parking, because it's not for people, it's just for cars, it's only 7 feet per story. It's actually a big machine inside this volume. So parking, and then we come up to terraces, these big setback terraces, which are green terraces, with laundry, gym, clubhouse, and then apartments above. The apartments are a mix of studios, one and two bedroom apartments that basically come up.
And how many total apartments?
97 apartments total. May increase them.
Which may change depending upon the mix of the students.
Right. And they are rental. They are rental apartments. They're meant to be reasonably priced, and they're meant to be of reasonable size so that cost point can be held. So here you can see the face of the building. Can't here see the top of these buildings, but they align. There are some solar panels across here that make alignment. This is the grocery store. This is the mezzanine, which you can come out onto, and you can have a bite to eat overlooking the street. People can see activity up here. And then this is a greenhouse that basically faces south on the side of the building and has trays with plants in it, like a greenhouse that you'd go into garden store. This is a kind of cut through it. And you see the greenhouse is, or the urban farm is in front of the parking. The nice thing about this parking is there's no idling machines. It's very well controlled. The in and out off the street is very well controlled. It's very safe, but it's not something we want to look at, like most parking garages. We don't want to look at them. So we use this urban farm idea for a couple things. I mean, one is really grow the food. We start to get used to this idea of growing the food that we need and seeing food being grown, which helps us all and explain to our kids where food actually comes from. And we can put it in front of this parking garage. Okay, and then the apartments look something like this. Now this building is a prefabricated building. It's something we've been working on in our firm for many years now. And it's made in a factory, which means that it's made under ideal environmental circumstances. It's made quickly at a very high quality. And when it comes to the site, it's built in about half the time of a normal building, which means basically less dirt, disruption, traffic, noise, all the things that come with construction. Living room, bedroom, bathroom, kitchen, entrance, separate, we'll be separating these out. Then balconies on each side with wood slat screens, which are made out of a special wood that makes very durable. And a little, if we move out, if we get a little further away from it, you can see what each of those pieces of the building looks like. The balconies basically run all the way across, and they help keep the sun off the facade and give people a little bit of privacy too. You can come behind the screen.
Excuse me, I'm just curious about something. You say that's a greenhouse?
That's right.
Okay, and I see people walking, you know,
down here.
The diagram is walking. Right. So when do you water that to keep it up?
Well, the way you do it is with automatic waterers. So I had a little lesson given me a while ago. We were asked to come go up to Cornell and work with their ag school on greenhouses. These greenhouses these days are totally computer controlled. The nutrients, the ventilation, the water, they're all let in through piping and by opening and closing vents. So that's the way it works. It's a totally controlled environment. Still drip irrigation. It's very cool. And then the plants then really thrive because of the way it's controlled. Okay, that's that. And then if we move out a little further, you can see all the pieces. Storefront, one driveway in, residential entry, mezzanine, the urban garden in front of the parking, photovoltaic panels, and then setback, about 30 feet setback. 30 feet back, it's hard to see in this kind of image, and then the balance of the building in this place. And then on Bangs, which is floating in, out, and in that case, on Bangs, we're going to show the robotic parking. We're going to show the apparatus. We're going to see through and see what's actually going on. So it'll be able to show. The side elevations are simple. They have all the structure that keeps the building from swaying in the wind. One there, so there. That's on the sides. Same paneling comes up, and this pretty much illustrates the idea of the massing of the building. So you can see that this zone, this height, is carried across. Building set well back. The materials, you can see the wood, the mesh, the painted metal for the balconies, fiber cement for some of the pieces and parts, the garden piece, glass and photovoltaic panels, which I guess are absorbing light as we speak. So that's it, that's the presentation.
Can we see the Bangs Avenue side to that as well?
It's very similar, but we haven't rendered it with a perspective, although we could. You can see it very, very similar. It comes down a little bit in height because the adjacent building comes down a bit in height. And it's glass, and we look through it, but in this case, we'll see this, the automobile moving up and down on their list.
Is that? It's actually the presentation.
Sure.
There's just a piece of that edge of the building showing the automobiles in their position. There's seven-foot-high sandwiches where they paste.
Hey, what you're looking at is essentially an iconic structure that would look or built here in Asbury Park. It has elements that really don't align in terms of vertical garden, vertical farm. The type of parking that we're looking to accomplish, the automated parking. You know, also with that grocery store that's going to be incorporated into the structure. Takes care, obviously, and contributes a lot to the parking issue that we have. I say it contributes to taking care of some of the parking issues that we have in the downtown, provides a grocery store, and you're creating an iconic structure that is completely unique to anything that you can see down at the Jersey Shore.
How high does the, in terms of stories instead of feet, how high does that block allow you to go currently?
Well, it's 11 stories of housing. We call this six stories, which is very low, so it's probably four stories of equivalent stories of parking.
That's a question.
No, so what is the Central Business District allow there now, currently?
96 feet.
And translate that into stories for me.
10.
Nine stories.
Okay. And you're asking for a total of how many stories?
16.
Approximately. Listen, you don't have to be exactly right. 16 stories. Okay. So an increase of 11.
Correct.
Yeah.
180 feet.
What were the square footage of the units?
The units vary. See, do you remember the exact size? I mean, they're in the 650 square feet for one bedroom, 850 for two bedroom.
And how many affordable?
That hasn't been determined, but certainly that'd be worth it. Assuming we don't have the count, the amount that we're going to put in there, we're not actually in full presentation yet in terms of the units. We have made that determination.
And that's currently a parking lot now, right? Next to SIBO?
Surface parking lot.
A surface parking lot. And how much parking is there now? I'm just curious.
100 spaces.
100 spaces.
And how much of that parking would be accessible by the general public?
Two-thirds of it.
I think 250 spaces would be dedicated to other buildings, other residential buildings, plus the building that we're being proposed. So on top of that, you're looking at 250 plus over 300 spaces would be for the public. I think we have downtown now 600 and some spaces, if I remember from the Desmond report. So that's more than 50% increase of the available.
And there would be a fee to park there, right?
Yes.
What's the time period on this?
In terms of actual construction of the building?
Yes. And finish, start and finish.
It's a 2-year project.
And is somebody managing the parking apparatus?
Yes.
So there's a person on site that manages that?
That's right, yes. There can be generators for backup and there's power.
So the real ask is height, right? That's the real ask.
The system, the parking system is made in Germany. They use that apparently in Europe a lot, the automated system. I think there's some that's being done in New York now.
There are three of them done in New York. This one works. There are some who follow this kind of thing that do not. This one does.
Hey, what's the tallest building in the Central Business District now, Michelle?
Gas building.
Okay. And how many stories?
I'm going to guess.
How many?
Close.
It's 20 something. It's either.
It's Pascal. It's the Pascal and Sabine's. The
yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. It's either it's 20 or 20 between 20 and 22, something in that range.
And then yeah. What's the second? Your best guess.
Red Monroe Towers, but it's not the CBD.
That's not the central business.
Gas company. Wait, you're saying gas company is less? Okay. I'm sorry. I spoke erroneously.
In the early 20s, Kevin, is that what you're saying?
No. The gas company building, I believe, is 11 stories. Off the top of my head.
Okay, so I'm way off. I'm sorry.
11 stories.
It's 10.
It's an office building. 11 stories.
Thank you.
And this is 16, so this is bigger than the gas building.
Hey,
usually, the office buildings are usually about 12 feet floor to floor.
Are they?
Residential.
Okay.
Residential.
I'm just trying to get a visual of how high it is.
Probably not a lot higher than a hutch, probably 1 or 2 stories.
No, it's 5 stories higher.
What's that?
It's 50% higher.
Well, the reason I think it may not be is because the gas building built as an office building before the floor is usually about 12 feet, so it preferred again more than a typical residential floor. And I've seen the building, I'm not far out of that.
But they're all follow-up questions we can submit and get the answers to.
We can be more precise.
Any other questions? Anything else?
So this is a request, an informal request to the central district?
This is just a proposal, there's no request.
This is a conceptual design, okay.
Ultimately, we're going to have to, I already submitted the application a while ago, we're going to have to get a referral over to the planning board for consideration of the plan amendment, then come back.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody want this?
I have one, I don't need to.
Next on the agenda is the review of agenda items for Wednesday night's meeting.
So I have a bunch of questions, Michael, are you going to, can you go through and do like some summaries first, and that might knock out some of them?
Yes. Starting at the consent agenda, the only one that could possibly be of question is the resolution 2016-461, which is insertion of a special item of budget. That is the petroleum assessment, that's the EPA grant that the city received. The city had received in September the $200,000 EPA grants. Later on the agenda is the award of it, but this puts the money into the budget so we can actually spend it. The accepting of donations from the Asbury Park Housing Authority, they're going to be here on Wednesday, as of now, to give some tablets for the police department for helping view their security cameras. Moving to individual resolutions,
let's stop at 465 per second. Are we throwing this away, selling it, or what?
We sell it on GovDeals. This will be the first part. There's
no vehicles.
There's no vehicles. We're still waiting for titles on those. There's about 8 vehicles that we have to get rid of. This is people cleaning out their offices. This is mostly computers, a lot of toner, and a lot of broken printers. So we're trying to lump those in together as one. There'll be another batch of items probably in the next month or two.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Moving to the individual resolutions, 466 is the standard moving of money between departmental line items.
Couple questions.
Yes.
How did we come up short on street lighting and fire hydrant service if it's been a constant throughout the years? Why didn't we budget enough this year?
That I don't know. Joanne is off this week, so I wasn't able to ask the transfer questions, but I'll have more when I can look at them and talk to James on Wednesday.
And then as far as salaries and wages, why did we under budget those two items? Just because no staff has been added. So why would like the sewer plant need another $30,000? And it's not marked as overtime, it's marked as salaries.
Again, I'll have to look at it. I didn't get the chance to talk to Joanne. $468 and $469. This is required of pension and benefits. If an individual can no longer perform the job duties, we have to petition the state to say that there's an involuntary disability retirement. They provide myself with the documentation from the doctor's notes, and then we have to submit it this way. Resolution 470 is the GO30 code enforcement software. This has been talked about for about 18 months, which will allow code enforcement to actually track violations, inspections, COs, CCOs, and transfer of titles. This also works in conjunction with one of the ordinances that I'll get to in a couple minutes.
When will it be up and running?
Right now, it's going to be dependent upon the final adoption of the property maintenance code. We're aiming early January, but obviously, we need to put the section of code into the software, so when someone writes a violation, they can check it off.
So we're awarding the bid on this, but it doesn't say what it costs.
It is $5 per inspection. It's in their proposal. So there's no flat fee of like...
Oh, there's no flat, okay.
Like 50 grand, it's per inspection.
And what, okay. What do we charge for an inspection?
Depends on which inspection, if it's a re-inspection.
So then we up those fees by $5? Is that how we do it?
We're going to address that early next year. We'll see how many inspections come in, what they're going to charge. And we're still working on some of the aspects of, you know, moving the CO and CCO into the software. So it's just going to be a data number. And if we have to raise the fee to cover it, we'll definitely propose that. The resolution authorizing the City of Asbury Park to enter into a joint purchasing agreement. This is for ammunition. This was done last year. It saved us money, so we're proposing to do it again.
It doesn't have a dollar amount. I don't care. But...
It depends on how much has to be purchased.
Okay.
And since multiple towns are involved in it, obviously the higher the quantity, the cheaper the cost it turns out to be. Resolution 472 is to renew the contract with the State of New Jersey for the Bangs Avenue Garage. This contract sunsets in February of next year. This would be for the exact same terms for 5 years, extending it from February, with one change, is that in this agreement, we actually are putting in what spaces we own, monitor, and control. This was completed earlier this year with myself, the mayor, Kevin, the police department, and DPW. This is the first time they've actually been delineated, but the state didn't want to make any changes, so except for putting in that these are the spaces, which was one of the bones of contention.
So Michael, where it says third and final renewal?
The original agreement, approximately 10 years ago, said 3 5-year renewals. This will be the third. So in 2022, something has to be done with either another agreement, you know, saying that we're going to do a fourth 5-year, something along those lines. But obviously we want to get this done sooner than later just so we don't miss it.
And then weren't you following up with the state regarding the Bangs Up Garage of making it going stories higher, adding stories to it?
That was proposed. It's not going to be feasible just due to the cost and the structure itself. It never was built to add on to it. So it wouldn't be feasible at all. But we did ask.
Mike, when the last time I built had been inspected?
The garage?
Yeah.
A month ago.
Okay, thank you.
Resolution 2016-473 is authorizing T&M to prepare a New Jersey Department of Transportation grant application. This is what is commonly referred to as the municipal aid program. We are proposing Heck Street, which really isn't a street, but more of a dirt road at this point in time. If we don't receive the money, we're also proposing this in the general road improvement program for next year, but this is the worst street right now after we finish with this program in the city. The cost of this is approximately $3,500, which is in line with what they've been charging the last couple of years to do this, because they do have to submit plans. Resolution 474 is to award the EPA grant, which was mentioned previously under the Chapter 159. Staff is recommending award for approximately $370,000 to BRS Associates. If you remember, this was publicly bid once, rejected because it was, we thought the cost was too high. We made some tweaks and the cost came still in at the same. This is all grant funded through the EPA. It doesn't cost us anything. 475 and 476.
Let me go back to 474 for a second. I apologize.
Mm-hmm.
Who else applied?
There was approximately 8 applicants. Only 3 met the requirements. I had to disqualify 5 because they didn't meet the ethics statement. It was BRS, T&M, and the Lewis Group, Lewis Consulting, who did not supply a second phase because there's 2 parts, there's 2 grants. They only submitted for 1 part, which was the first part. T&M and BRS's applications were off by $4,000 approximately each. BRS's had a more nimble staff. I felt that in the ranking and rating that they can get things done a little bit quicker than going up through T&M's chain of command. But both applications were actually very, very well done. And at that point, when you're that close you know that the funding, because they were both the same way the last time.
And you might have said this, and so I apologize. What are the exact locations of the properties?
We don't know at this time.
Okay, well, if you go to the fifth whereas, it says the contract is not expected to exceed $400,000, and the sixth whereas says we only have $200,000. Where's the other $200,000?
There's two $200,000 grants for $400,000.
Doesn't state that.
No, I was confused by that as well.
It was probably my drafting error, because the final number.
That's easy to correct.
Yes, it is, but I put the.
We have 400.
We'll change the language.
$400,000 is the grant max, but their bid came in significantly less. I will correct that error. But if you remember, we don't have, under the grant, it was a area that we will determine four sites that, for assessment, in conjunction with property owners, that it's the swath of Springwood Avenue up Memorial and Main Street.
Who's we?
You, in consult, with the consultant. Like, the consultant will give us recommendations of the sites that have the greatest potential for successful cleanup.
Okay. On the back page, I guess it's 209. The anticipated term of this contract is for 3 years to expire, 1 year from execution, so.
That's another drafting error on my part, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Because we're already behind with EPA with granting this, and I rushed to write the resolution as quickly as I could.
Okay, thank you.
475 and 476 are there as placeholders depending on the executive session for Wednesday, so those may be pulled. Moving on to ordinances. We're gonna skip 53, because that's gonna be the longer discussion right now. 2016-54 adds two members to the planning board. Special event fees is 55, which increases the fees for next year upon review of staff's recommendation and the recommendation from the special events committee. And 56 and 57, create positions within the city of Asbury Park. Right now, we have tentative ideas for internal IT. The 56 addresses that with three positions, three titles, depending on applicants, if we elect to go this route. The current situation is we use a consultant who is not always available. With the police department having 12 servers, the city having three, the fire department having one that's older than all of us combined, we are in a great struggle to manage anything. Right now, I'm doing a lot of that, Kirby's doing it, and Kevin and someone in the fire department. We can't be doing this at all times. We do need someone in-house, there is enough work to do this, and we're probably gonna be proposing this as a full-time position for next year. The consultant, they do what they can, but they're not here, and that's a major, major problem. So this would give the ability to pay someone if we go the route of hire them, whether it's a network person, who a little bit more of network or more of just a generalized tech services. Right now, we just can't handle what we do. We're too big to have an outside vendor do it who's not on call 24/7, especially with the police department. And there's been instances where it's like, oh, we'll get to you in 2 or 3 days. We can't wait 2 or 3 days for things that are happening. So that's gonna come hopefully early next year within the budget process. And 57 involves the court. The court administrator has asked that we do this. In speaking with Ms. Green, what happens in the court rules, in the AOC rules, is you need to be a certified court administrator or a certified deputy administrator to sign certain documents. Right now, most of the staff is certified. So this will help them with efficiency of trying to get people and documents signed, whether it's by, the judge or the AOC itself. It allows them, for example, to make bank deposits if someone's on vacation. So it's gonna allow for more flexibility. Patty, I told Patty, I don't see an issue putting in place these positions by ordinance. But we'll have to talk about what the cost is going to be if we do it. This is just, if it does work, we present it in the budget, it's going to allow the court to have more flexibility and operate under a little bit more efficiency. But this, again, just like 56, it just allows us the opportunity, and we obviously have to come back to you guys for these things.
Does 57, the court, does it increase the personnel, or does it just change somebody's job title?
It creates the job titles that we don't have now. It wouldn't do anything involving creating personnel. It would be a promotional opportunity for the server.
Right, it would be somebody that's already working.
Yes.
Just get this title to make it easier to sign off on things.
Yes.
Okay.
Because you can only be sign off if you're certified under those two titles, deputy or director. It's an AOC rule. They instituted about 2 years ago, I think.
Seems like it's backwards that number three would be making more than number two, but that's just...
Civil service.
Welcome to the state of New Jersey.
So the big one on the ordinances is 2016-53, an ordinance amending the property improvement and neighborhood preservation, the property maintenance code. Earlier this year, we gave a, mine doesn't, I have to hold this, a presentation on the property maintenance code. As you know, we use the 1997 FOCA code, and we're proposing moving to the 2015 International Property Maintenance Code. Under state law and the International Property Maintenance Code itself, we can make some changes to the language, much like you can under the old BOCA code. So what does the property maintenance code changes do? It allows for standards. The example I gave last time is the BOCA code says you're not allowed to have abandoned vehicles, plural. This says you are not allowed to have abandoned vehicles at all. This provides, the other example I had given was under rodents, that the current code says you have to abate the rodents. This code actually says you have to abate and then subsequently follow up with it. So there's actually two separate offenses moving forward for things. It sets standards for windows, door locks, door handles, which we don't have currently. The most important thing involving this, in my opinion, is the discretionary aspect. Under BOCA, our hands are a little bit tied, where if today someone's sidewalk, we find this to be cracked, they have to fix it. This allows us now a little bit more discretion to say, you have until March when it's not freezing out, without any, with the appropriate citations. As I mentioned, this also goes in line with the software. Currently, right now, what happens is, say Kevin's property, we find a violation. We actually put it in a paper file, and then to actually write a citation, we have to go find a subsequent paper file and put it into our admin software. It just doesn't work. So the property maintenance aspect of it will also be shared with the police and fire department, where they know if they're going into a house, if there's been violations recently. So it's a cloud-based system that's gonna have the new code in it. The new code does allow for a lot more discretion and time factors for the staff, which is going to be huge, and sets up the standards. The other two aspects of the code is it creates uniformity in the CO, CCO, and TCO inspection process, which we don't have now. And the second biggest aspect is the landlord registration. Currently, right now, we don't have any avenue to register landlords. Excuse me. The change in the code will create the landlord registration depository or repository, however you want to call it. The goal, as we're going to be recommending, is to do inspections every 3 years of these properties. For example, if we have 6,000 properties that are registered, we're obviously going to have a problem then inspecting 6,000 properties at once. So Mr. McEwing and myself have come up with a plan to do this. What we were recommending as part of the ordinance is, in the ordinance it says everyone must register. So over the first 3 or 6 months of the year, we get the registration in. And then we'll determine, say, if there's that 6,000, we can break it into 2,000 a year, 2017, 2018, 2019, and then we have the rolling system of units. Before we do that, though, obviously there has to be an inspection fee. We don't know what that could be, because we do know we're going to need an administrative assistant to help. Maybe we need another part-time employee or two part-time employees. We're not going to be sure until we can get this in. So in the code right now, that section's actually reserved. And once we start to the ball rolling with the registrations, we'll come back to you saying this is what it looks like it's going to cost us to do full-fledged implement. One of the more important things involving the registration is often the most underlooked. It's finding the tenants and finding the tenant's name. Because, for example, earlier this year where someone blew out their kitchen, well, we don't know if there's someone that wasn't in that house, or if there's a house fire, we don't know who and how many people, and give us the primary and secondary contact information, which again, it's cloud-based, we can share with police and fire. It's just gonna make data easier. Those are those three in a nutshell. The two obvious big ones is the registration, which we're holding in reserve, and the property maintenance code, which updates it to today's standards. And I know there's gonna be questions on that, so I'll open it up to any questions.
When an owner registers, is it just registering the LLC that owns the building, or is it gonna be an individual who's gonna be responsible in the event that you have to reach out to them for some reason?
The registration is the owner, but we also require who's the managing partner of it, the managing group. So if I own a property, Kevin's my property manager, we both are gonna be on the form.
So for me, it would have been, if we had like a red line copy of what our previous one was and what this, because I'm having trouble figuring out what's new. So obviously I know the landlord registration's new, but we have a certificate of rental compliance. Is that the CO?
Yes.
That's what normally referred to as the CO. Okay.
Yes.
And why aren't we calling it a CO?
It's just the name on the form.
Okay, so let's start with page.
So I agree with Amy. Is there a red line version?
I mean, this is so thick to me. I read it once, I'll read it again before Wednesday, but it felt like a tremendous amount for me to take in one reading.
Yeah, I can provide that.
Perfect, thank you.
Okay, so page 367, number E.
I said the ordinance, section number?
Section 104. Okay, the city council finds that a periodic inspection of rental units other than owner-occupied two-family buildings is necessary to promote the preservation of such housing. So if it's an owner-occupied two-family building, I guess I'm not sure why you're carving that out. You carve out owner-occupied two-family.
Because it's not considered multifamily in the definition. Multifamily is three or more as per the local and the state definitions. So owner and another unit is not considered multifamily.
Where is it referring to multifamily? It's rental regulations and registration of rental properties and landlords.
Because three or, as it's described, single family with one unit is two, and two doesn't meet any code of a multifamily dwelling. We can make that more clear, but a multifamily dwelling is three or more units.
So this talks about the rental regulations for properties, right? So if I have a two-family house and I live in one and I want to rent out the other, I assume the other unit that I'm renting out is covered under these regulations in the property management section, right?
No, it's not a multifamily.
But it's a rental dwelling.
You would have to register, yes. But under the property maintenance aspect of it, no, that's what you asked. You would still have to register your rental unit. All rental units would have to be registered.
Okay.
But under some of the property maintenance code and this side of it is only gonna refer to the multifamily dwellings. It's the implementation of it. That yes, if a property, if you have a single family home, and your gutters are falling off. Yes, that's the general code. But as I'm understanding your question, it would be the rental property falling under the property maintenance code. I think, if I'm understanding you correctly, you're looking at two things, the registration and property maintenance at the same time.
Okay.
If that's what you're asking.
I honestly, I now don't even remember my question.
Sorry.
So I'll put a pin in that and I'll call you and Rob about that one. Page 368, 104-3, the registration. It says all forms will be available at the clerk. I assume you're gonna put them online so Cindy's not getting all these people coming in
Yes.
You should put, is on file with the clerk and on our website or something on there? Just because there would be more than one means to get it?
Why does it go to the clerk and not the code department? I mean, if it's all gonna be dealt with upstairs, why do they start?
Actually, I did talk to Rob about it, he was gonna take it over.
Okay.
But I mean, it just seems like another layer of like, some getting lost. If they come in and register with Cindy, then it's gotta go upstairs.
We'll change that section.
I think the law for landlord registration in the.
I was gonna ask, is that?
States the city clerk's office.
The state law is.
However, we can do a designate and not ref, and not.
Yeah, and it says designate, so. But if you want that clear, we can change that to be clearer. But I think the city clerk and the designate, and then to be.
Okay, no, okay, I didn't see the designate, okay. It just makes more sense to me that if it's all gonna go upstairs, it should start upstairs too.
I completely understand your concern, but I do agree that it may be that we have to reference the city clerk, but having the designate in there allows us to say, well, it's actually up in, you know, the director of property improvement, but.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
Under the registration, the 104-3, number D. So in the event the tenancy changes during the year, the landlord, owner, or managing agent shall, within 10 days of the change in tenancy, provide an updated rental property registration for each unit in which a change in tenant has occurred. Can you just explain that to me?
If you move out, we get to inspect the property. And you have to change your tenancy form. This is also based upon the state law. Under the Landlord Registration Act right now, which Cindy is supposed to get those forms, anytime there's a change in tenancy, that form is supposed to go to Cindy.
So if you, if, let's say tenants are moving out on the 1st and new tenants are moving in on the 15th. Between the 10th and the 15th, you have to fill out a form, and then after the 15th, you have to fill out another form, one to say it's vacant, one to say there's now tenants in it?
Yes.
I mean, that seems a little ridiculous.
I don't believe so, because now we know that the property is vacant, so one, we can watch it, two, make sure that there's no shenanigans going on there, for, especially on a short-term rental. And three, that's actually the state law on the registration, that anytime a tenant moves in and out, they're supposed to notify the clerk.
So, from a practical point of view, if you're renting, if you're yearly, I mean, short-term, that would be a disaster for, right? I mean, the short-term's not even really part of this, right? The short-term rentals, they have, they're under their own.
Yes, which you guys are discussing.
Okay, so if you have a unit, you're renting it yearly, people are moving out on the 30th, you're re-renting it on the 15th or the following month, you're coming to the city twice to fill out a registration form.
Well, you would come to the city, I think, once. You would know who your tenant's gonna be, so, and these forms are gonna be available online.
But it's within 10 days. So within 10 days, you're filling out this form.
If you're, if you have a tenant leaving and you know someone's coming in 15 days, you know that they're coming in. So if you, if I rent my place out, if my tenant left on the 30th, comes in on the 15th, you know who that tenant is on the 15th.
But they have to be inspected first.
Yes.
Oh, you didn't say that, man.
We're just talking about the registration of it. You're gonna know who your tenant's gonna be.
So so a person has to go fill out a rental property registration 10 days after a change in the tenancy?
Yes.
So I guess what I'm saying is, you would be filling that out twice in 1 month, because you would be filling it out when the person moves out, and then in theory, let's say you had it re-rented quickly, didn't know who, but you had it re-rented quickly, and then you would come back and fill it out again. So you fill it out for the 10, anything past 10 days that it was vacant, and then you go back again and fill it out again for your new tenant.
Yes.
I just wanna make sure I understand that correctly.
Yes.
Okay.
Michael, what is our plan for getting this into the hands of landlords?
The Landlord Association, we're gonna, you know, the obvious, the website, newspaper ad. Rob and I actually talked about hosting a public meeting. He's talked to a bunch of the realtors already, to say this is coming, this is what the thoughts are, and that took part of how this in place.
Yeah.
So it's gonna be a lot of outreach, and that's why we're not concerned about the registration and the registration fee yet.
I don't understand either.
because we know we're going to miss a bunch of people, because they're just not going to hear it first. But we also can do, the idea is, in our financial software, we run the tax bills, we can run the report of 123 Elm Street, that owner has a mailing address of Long Branch. When we run that report, we can export it to Excel, and you know that it's a different tax address, which is usually going to be a landlord. So we can get it out that way too.
Oh, I got more.
So do I later, but while we're on your thing, while we're on 104-3. The B, the rental property shall be filed on an hour basis on or before April 1st. What happens if it's not?
Then it's a fine.
Where's that stated in here?
There is language, and I'll find it for you, that anyone who is in conflict may receive a penalty.
Okay.
But maybe we should put that right after where we say you have...
Well, we found out by making a fine on late mercantile licenses, everybody paid on time.
Penalty is on page 373.
Penalty is on page 373. What is, okay, and just to sidetrack for a second, I know we want to get this up and running as quick as possible, but I agree with Eileen and Amy about the red line. We got to know what's changing. There's going to be a lot of review. So what is the process of this? When would you like to see this done? Because I don't see this being done on Wednesday.
Well, what we can do, if there's questions on the registration, we can pull out the registration section, hold that in reserve, and go with the property maintenance code. The property maintenance code is much more of the time-sensitive one, so we can get the software up and running. And that one, we added like the discretionary language. If you guys are not comfortable, we adopt this, hold that section in reserve, or just pull it out entirely. It's easier to do reserve. And then just wait.
So, Michael,
I just feel that we should wait. I'm not satisfied with what I'm hearing. I don't know about the rest of it.
Well, I'm bless not you. Done with my questions.
Yeah. let's bang out the rest of the questions.
Okay.
At this point, I agree with you.
Okay, so one of the things that's different about this is the certificate of rental compliance, which is what's commonly referred to as the CO. So, after 3 years, can you just take us through exactly what happens from, you get your certificate of rental compliance. The same people live there for 3 years. The city's gonna come back out and reinspect the unit.
100% correct.
Okay, and how are we going to do that for almost 6,000 units in Asbury Park?
Well, as I mentioned, I'm trying not to get the feedback. We're gonna do the outreach and the communication to all the properties that we know. And then as we get that database, if there's 6,000 rental units, I'm just using just general numbers, we can take 2017, 2018, and 2019, and then start the systematic 3 years, because we know it's physically impossible to hit every rental unit next year. So it's just gonna be the random sampling of here's 2,000, here's 2,000, here's 2,000, here's 1,500, whatever the number is gonna be, because also one of the things is we don't expect everyone to register. So this can get us out there too, to get everyone registered. And then we can start hitting it, because there is no way we can hit every rental property in the city within a year.
I think the good landlords will absolutely register. I think the problem
is going to be
won't
the problem.
Register.
Yes.
So I guess my point too is that having our good landlords come and do this and then put them on 17, 18, and 19 is fine. You know, in theory, I don't necessarily have a problem with that. But all of the property owners that absolutely aren't going to register, that are all over the city and their properties look terrible to say the least. I mean, what's the plan for them?
We'll find them, because we know, as in Edmonds especially, if you're renting out your property, you're going to send your tax bill to another address. We know that, because you have to, or else you're not gonna get the tax bill and it's gonna be a problem. So we have that very good database of people right off the bat. If they don't register, it's a fine. And every single day thereafter is a fine. So there is the incentive that you should be, you have to be registering, or else we're gonna fine you.
I think the problem the city's had for years, Michael, and well before your time, is that the people who you want to register don't. Right, they're the people.
Yes.
They're the problem. All right, section 108, the notices and orders.
What page?
page 378. It's actually 108.7 notice requirements. So again, and when we have the redline version, I'll have a better idea if this is something that we already had. But so, for example, you have 48-hour notice period prior to the issuance of a summons for failure to remove weeds, plant growth deemed as a nuisance, or any other violations in the discretion of the code or officer deemed compliant with this section. Is that new language, or is that language that we've that has already existed?
It's already existing, and the key there, excuse me again, is the discretion. Right now, we don't have that discretion, but if someone is away for a week, we don't want to hammer them, which has happened in the past. We've gotten complaints about that, and especially when you have that first growing season where people might not get landscapers in on time, it allows us to actually have some discretion, where now it's just 48 hours, you shall.
Okay, page 396. So dumpsters have to be placed upon plywood to protect the surface against ruts. Is that something we currently have, or is that new?
No, we don't. We've talked about having that language in on public roadways or on newly paved driveways. We want to see how it works first before we have to amend it. The mayor brought this up under the last time you guys had the code. He had called me on it because we have dumpsters that are on asphalt that aren't on anything. But it's much more aimed at public roadways or freshly paved driveways or sidewalks where it will make indentations. We don't know how many we're going to get with that. It's one of those things we actually don't anticipate really enforcing, but it's something that we should have in there just in case, especially as we move towards doing new road programs. We want to be able to protect the roadways.
396.
What section?
32.14, remove. Order to remove. So in a nutshell, it says essentially grass, weeds, dead or dying trees, stumps, roots, obnoxious growth, or filth. You have 3 days to remove it. And I guess my point with some of them, like obviously the dead or dying trees, you're not going to get a tree guy out to remove the tree in 3 days. I mean, it would take a couple of weeks, and it doesn't say anything about discretion of the code department there.
That would be under the notice, as you mentioned before, with the discretionary aspects. Mm-hmm. And the immediate urgent need is what matters. If a tree is leaning on someone's house, you're going to get a tree person there within a day or two.
But it's not, it says just dead or dying trees or stumps. So if I have a stump that the city decides is now a risk of some sort, I have 3 days to get tree people out to remove it?
Or the discretion of the code enforcement officer under the section that you previously mentioned. The goal is anything that's an emergent need needs to come out. Anything that isn't, the officer is going to have discretion.
You know what? Let me look at the red line version instead of, and then I'll see how we had it worded before.
Couple questions. Page 336.
What section?
63. 102.6, historic buildings. Says the provision of the code shall not be mandatory. The entire CBD is historic buildings. So we're eliminating the entire CBD to these codes?
What section was that?
102.6.
This section is the provisions of this code shall not be mandatory for existing buildings or structure designated as historic buildings where such buildings or structure are judged by the code official to be safe and in the public interest of health, safety, and welfare. That means if there's a weed, it doesn't apply. Or if there's some facade issues, which are going to come under historic guidelines. But But if the building is falling over, then it can come under the code official. Because the interest there is the public interest of health and safety.
So if the building had glass knobs or whatever?
If you painted a building black in the central business district, it's not going to violate this section of the code.
Just because, again, not being a lawyer, just because it's like on the second page of a new, this is the code for the city of Asbury Park per apartments and everything. The second page says, any historic building is exempt. Just scares the hell out of me. It can be interpreted like, well, you don't have to get a CO, you don't have to do anything.
Only if it's in the interest of health, safety, or welfare. You still have to do the COs.
So why is that even listed?
Because there's aspects that, under historic preservation, we can't touch. If the facade is falling down. If the facade is cracked and it's not interested in public safety, they're going to have to maintain something. The doorknobs, as Councilwoman Clayton was saying, or the doors, those aren't going to be the health, welfare of public safety. But if the facade is falling down and we need to hire a scaffolding company, that's an issue.
What did our previous code say about historic buildings?
Nothing.
Okay.
And if I could just ask about the historic buildings aspect. I know we don't have a historic preservation commission or designation at the local level. So is this referring to those that are formally designated on the national or state registers of historic places?
It would have to be, yes.
Just so as to make it clear as to, you know, anybody could say, well, this is a historic building.
Designated, yes.
I think further on someplace it does say that.
I think we need to make this as easy for people to understand as possible, and we're having trouble understanding it, so.
Right, well, I think the redline version is going to help a lot with that. And I think separating the two, like you said, if the one has to be done, then if you want the first one done, I would say you put all effort and time into that.
Yeah, it shouldn't be an issue pulling out. You know, there are the sections of it, so it's just deleting that section in one copy and putting reserved. And we'll know where the placeholder is.
103.5 fees. As per city ordinance. So what's on board now would be on board until they're changed.
Yes.
You answered that.
There would be an increase in fees in theory because we're providing more services, right? Landlord registration.
A landlord registration fee would be just for landlord registration. There'd be no fee increase because of the property maintenance code.
But we don't even require landlord registration now, do we?
By law, they're supposed to.
Page 369, 104.4, exceptions. The provisions of this section shall not apply to public housing authorities, not-for-profit housing operations, and rental properties restricted to senior. Why? I can understand some of them maybe.
The state has those. The state does those inspections. We can't touch them until we, at some point in time, take over from the state for those units, but we can't touch them right now.
Well, maybe, again, I'm confused about this. So let's say, like, the Michaels, 64 units, or the Turf, 20 units. They're being run by not-for-profit housing corporations. We're not going to be giving their COs out, the state is?
No, we give out the COs, but involving any of the registration or the property, the inspections, that's all the state. Like, they do it on a five-year basis.
The Turf Club will be inspected by the state, not the city?
As far as my understanding, yes.
But the housing authority, so if you go into the housing, if the housing authority calls code and say they have no heat or hot water, you're saying the city doesn't respond to that?
Heat and hot water is an emergent use. We do respond and then notify the state. Like when their elevator, they had an elevator issue in one of their units, that's an emergent need. The fire department was there. Code was there. The elevator is obviously
but
an emergent
code
need.
Code didn't give out a CO for any of the units in... They don't inspect any of the units in the Asbury Park Housing Authority.
No, that's state. State does the nonprofit entities, adults with developmental disabilities. We don't touch those. There wasn't a handshake agreement probably about 10 years ago That we would go in as a courtesy for some of the nonprofits, but that has gone by the wayside as they said, we don't want you there. We have no jurisdiction there.
Well, if I was a landlord and I was trying to get around this and not paying the fees and not being up to thing, I would just put it in a nonprofit thing and leave it up to the state. I mean, every 5 years instead of every 3 years.
And then we can take it over from the state. We can petition the state to take over everyone and do everything. I don't know where that flight came from for every 3 years.
Page 372, 104.8, it says fees reserved. What does that mean?
That section is for the annual rental inspections.
Okay. On page 383, 110.5, cost of emergency repairs. I just want to make sure this also covers if we have to go after somebody, that all legal fees are covered like we've done with everything else. So when we lien somebody, are the legal fees also being liened?
Yes, it's a municipal charge. That's okay. Under the tax code.
Just staying on fees for a minute, how come the fees for buildings were in it? I mean, how come that was kept? So on page 431, it talks about the initial registration, first renewal, second renewal, and it has the fees in that section of it.
What section number?
802-1.5, and it's packet page 431.
That is the existing abandoned property or vacant property ordinance.
So those fees are staying into this, the same?
Those, all fees are staying the same.
Okay.
The title of that is found on 802.
And this is for vacant properties.
It moves everything into the proper, we're codifying it for the codifier.
111.1, page 383, 384. I'm sorry, it's about demolition. Is that the same language? 6 months approval by the construction official? Is that consistent?
The construction code official would have all jurisdiction over demolition.
The 6 months is the same again. This is where the red line is going to help us.
Yes, that doesn't change.
Page 392, 302.9, motor vehicles. B. No trailer of any size which provided enclosed storage shall be parked, blah, 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 blah. So right now you have those little pod storage things that people can use if they're like moving or something like that. So we're telling everybody in Asbury Park you can no longer use those?
No, a pod for moving is acceptable. This is like a trailer where you put a NASCAR in it because it's under motor vehicles. Mm-hmm. It would be a trailer for like working on a car.
Who's going to determine, well, where does it say a pod's acceptable? Who's going to be the decision maker? Give me the definition of a trailer. To me, they're trailers.
This falls under motor vehicle section. If you want to regulate pods, which I don't believe is in here.
No.
It's not regulated.
Just want to make sure whoever's enforcing that knows that they're not considered trailers.
You're not going to put them, it says it's under the motor vehicle section. It's under 302.9, which is motor vehicles. So unless you're putting a motor vehicle in a pod or some sort of shed like that, you're going to be exempt from that. And if you read the section two, or being used in connection with a temporary function, a pod getting ready to move is a temporary function.
Page 395. Has to do with graffiti. We have like 8 pages on graffiti. 302.10.13, right of city to remove. The way I interpret this, if somebody was to go down to Sunset Avenue Pavilion and graffiti the artwork, the city would have to go down there and fix it. And that makes no sense to me.
It would always go to the owner if you see section 302.10.10, a property owner who has been ordered to remove graffiti. If they don't remove the graffiti, that gives us the right to remove it. If you want that cleaned up to be a little bit
Yeah, because, okay, 302.10 says that, but that didn't bother me, but when I got to 302.10.13, it bothered me where it says,
We'll throw it in there.
It's up to the city to remove it and fix it. On page 408, 308.3, disposal of garbage. This is something that we get into yearly with either new landlords or new owners. It doesn't state the size of a proper garbage container. So why not state it once and for all? Is it 60 gallons? Is it 52 gallons? Is it 40 gallons? It's not mentioned here once. And it says you got to put out your garbage in a proper container. Why not tell them what the proper container size is?
Because from my understanding, the container size has changed in the bid specs that the city has issued over the years.
So why not find one and set it and keep it?
We can do that.
Okay. I mean, that way somebody moving in won't go out to Home Depot and buy a 64-gallon container, then have 10 of them, and then say, hey,
it's 55 right now.
$1,000.
It's size and or weight right now. I think it's 55 gallons or 60 pounds, something like that.
Okay. I think the size should be determined, because I think that that's where they get into we're not picking up over 64 gallons or whatever. So
we actually had earlier this year someone had a 30 gallon container and filled it with cement.
Right.
And we wouldn't
nobody,
pick that up.
Nobody should pick that up. I agree. So put in the size and put in the weight.
Is there anywhere in here where it specifies how many trash cans or dumpsters should be needed for apartment buildings?
That is in the land development regulations.
Okay, because I've heard complaints that some of the apartment buildings don't have sufficient trash cans and people are throwing trash in public trash cans.
Public trash cans, and what we've actually seen, especially on the west side, is contractors are dumping into the dumpsters at like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning and filling them up, and when they come to dump them, there's just debris everywhere already. So that's a planning issue to make sure that things are screened properly and locked down. We've been working with a lot of the units over on the west side with that.
My last question, page 418, 506.3, grease interceptors. So now we're going to be clear. Grease traps, whatever you want to call them, are inspected by code. Because in the past, we don't know who does it, so nobody was doing it. And then we get a grease backup, and then we're paying thousands of dollars because of a sewer backup. So now it's going to be enforced by code?
Code and or the building department. The building department has acquired the software to do the annual inspections. This gives us another avenue to go after someone if they're not doing it. The building department has been doing this and doing the inspections for about 6 months now since we purchased the software. It tied into Mitchell Humphreys. So they've been doing the inspections, but this also gives us another avenue because, as you know, grease is absolutely horrible in the sewer lines.
So should we change that to or they're designated?
It's in the plumbing code. So it's in the plumbing subcode already, so we don't need to change that.
Okay. That's all the questions I had. But I think if you're looking to get something passed by Wednesday, we're going to need a lot of information.
No, it's first introduction Wednesday.
What we'll do is
it's going to change a lot from first to second introduction. Fred's going to throw it right out the window, correct?
Yeah, if you're looking to get something adopted by the end of the year, then we need to revise it, maybe abbreviate it, so that it's in a form that you're willing to introduce and adopt. Because you can't carry something, you can't introduce something in 1 year and then adopt it in another. Either you take this or an abbreviated version and introduce it Wednesday and adopt it at the second meeting in December, or you wait until after that.
We'd be looking at Chapter 13, Section 300, which is the property maintenance code. So anything before that, other than definitions, just to have the definitions we pull out. We would reserve the...
What page, Michael?
I don't have pages. It's Section 300. That's the property maintenance code itself. And Section 100 is the scope of intent, which we keep...
You know what, can you send, will you email me?
Starts here.
The section he's talking about?
388. And goes all the way to the back?
It goes to the back. What we'll do is pull out the registration requirement, because also in this codifies the proper, the vacant and abandoned housing ordinances, which were already there and now cross-references things.
So whatever he's saying, Cindy, can you just email it to me?
Once we revise it through the system, I'll make sure everybody gets a new copy, as well as make sure you guys get a hard copy as well.
And you'll get a memo from me saying, this is what was pulled, this is why, this is the property maintenance code, this is this section, these are the important ones. And anything that's, could be questionable, we'll just pull out and continue these discussions. Work for you.
Once you introduce something on Wednesday, if you then change it in a substantive manner between first reading and second reading, that means you would be able to adopt it in second meeting December, and you'd have to start over again.
The most important from the staff side of thing is the property maintenance. You already have on the books the vacant and abandoned housing, but this puts it into one clean section, and the COs, CCOs, which we're not changing anything with, it just adds it to the code. So we'll pull out the landlord registration, keep property maintenance, and the other sections are gonna be just changing the ordinance numbers. And you'll get a memo on that probably tonight or tomorrow morning.
Okay. Make some hard copies, please.
Any other matters review for Wednesday's meeting? Okay, we'll move on to matters by city council.
I have nothing at this time.
Nothing.
Judges?
Yeah, I just wanna thank the different organizations and the different people that participated in the tree lighting service at Convention Hall and Main Street and Springwood Avenue. And I just wanna say thank you to them, because it was beautiful and all free. And we as council people and residents, we really appreciate, we also appreciate the people coming out too, so I thank you, go out to them. That's all.
Just to also add on to what Jesse said, the tree lighting at Springwood Ave, I thought was great. I thought the city staff and Yvonne and everybody did a really fantastic job. It was great to see so many people out in such a cold day. The other thing that APTV did today was tape the Asbury Park High School soccer team, who won their first state championship after 35 years. So we taped a couple of members of the Asbury Park High School soccer team and their coach, and we're gonna put it up, but it was an absolutely lovely discussion and a really amazing group of kids. And I think so often we don't get to highlight them as much as we want to, but the soccer kids who won the state championship and their coach really did a really amazing job.
The last time we met, it was before the football state championship, so we wished them luck, and they played a great game, and they won, so again, we congratulate them. Both the soccer team and the football team and the cheerleaders will be recognized at a future meeting. I believe Jesse, Eileen, and Alicia are working together with the city manager and the superintendent of schools, how to properly do it at probably two different meetings, because we want as many student athletes and their parents here together. If we have them both on the same night, just may be overcrowded, so that will be done after the probably first of the year. But again, congratulations to the high school football team on a great season, and that's it.
Matters by the city manager. We do have snow removal under it.
Yes.
Previously, it had been discussed about the snow removal plan. There has been a plan internalized by Public Works. The most important public communication and outreach aspect of it is the alternate side of the street parking when a storm stops. So the plan is going to call for that once a storm stops, the first day after Evenside parks, I believe, I'll double check that, and the odd side is left empty so that the plows can go through that. We'll be able to do Nixle alerts and post it on the sign and the website, but that is the most public outreach aspect of the plan that entails. The rest of the plan is getting the plows ready and the vehicle checklist, but is the, what side of the street do I park on that is the most important aspect.
And what happens on those streets that don't have alternate side parking?
It's just even. It's just the even side versus odd side. We're just gonna keep it as simple as possible. Snow stops, you can park on even. The second day after, you park on the odd side.
I have questions about the snow plan, but I left that on my desk. I didn't bring it, so. I'll bring it Wednesday.
One quick question. And I think you said it may be pulled. I know we're gonna talk about, on 216-476, it wasn't in my package.
Maybe a 475.
Right, so we're all missing 476. But I know we're talking about it in closed exec, so.
Yeah.
Okay. Who's next?
All right, matters for city attorney.
I have nothing at this time.
Public participation. Each member of the public has 3 minutes to speak. Please state your name and address for the record, please. I know, I'm working on it.
You say a motion?
No.
I'm not sick.
Am I first? Good evening, Doug McQueen for Wesley Court. I just have a quick comment where I'd like to applaud the presentation that we saw earlier this evening from Sacman Enterprises. I know it's just preliminary and there's still a lot that we need to learn about their presentation, but even on its face, that presentation proposes a lot of factors that we should want downtown and that we do say we want in a healthy central business district. It's a dense residential development. It's got parking that we desperately need. It's environmentally friendly, includes a grocery store, and it brings 100 new housing units right downtown. So there's so much of that that we want. You know, we hear a lot at these council meetings that right now we're in an era where the CBD relies on people coming in from outside Asbury Park on the weekends, and a lot of them aren't very respectful to Asbury Park. And one of the ways we can evolve away from that is to be a more livable downtown, because instead of outsiders supporting our downtown economy, it's projects like this that we desperately need that provide this kind of infrastructure, a supermarket and residents, that will make our downtown more self-sustainable. So I know there's still hundreds of questions to be answered, including the one about the height, how tall the building is, but I would suggest that instead of focusing on just the height of the building, that we consider the total aspect of what that brings to our CBD, because so far on its face, it seemed really, really good. So just as the process moves along, I'd ask that you give that all of your consideration. Thanks.
Thank you. Motion to close.
Move it.
Second. Motion to adjourn.